Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Our Lady, Spouse of the Holy Spirit, pray for us. Saint Joseph, Saint Maximilian Mary Kolbe,
pray for us.
Blessed John Duns Scotus,
pray for us.
Saint Therese of the Child Jesus,
pray for us.
Our patron saints and guardian angels,
pray for us.
In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, amen. I hope that I always used to pray, as I do, Hail Mary to Our Lady, and later on I decided I should add always invoking my patron saint and my guardian angel, because sometimes I think they're the things we forget the most, are that we have a patron saint and we have a guardian angel, and we should invoke their aid and pray to them throughout the day, but especially before doing some particular activity, because they do take a great interest in us, especially if you've been named after a saint and you have a patron saint at baptism. Hopefully they name you after a saint and they didn't name you some northwest or southwest, or I know someone, they named their child Ocean Island and their last name is House. Now, how can you, names are very important. And as you know, in the Bible, naming things was very important. And so when you go to name your children, especially at birth and at baptism, really give it consideration. Who are you naming them after? And that you would choose, hopefully, those who have shown their love for God and heroic virtue in the saints. But tonight we're going to talk about why Mary, and we're going to talk about the five Marian stones. We briefly mentioned yesterday Blessed John Duns Scotus and how he had come, he taught this doctrine, and which was very much a part of the teaching of the church. It's pretty much accepted. Even though it's not defined dogmatically, it's part of the official magisterium of the church, the absolute primacy of Christ. But he's also, as I said yesterday, the one who was able to explain how Our Lady is immaculately conceived. He was the one who was able to explain the Immaculate Conception. And it's interesting that in his life as a young friar, he's from Scotland. That's why he's called Blessed John Duns Scotus. He was from Duns, Scotland. And even today, they have a statue of him there as their favorite son of little Duns, Scotland. So Duns Scotus, he was a Scotsman who was a friar, a Franciscan. And as a seminarian, he was having a hard time with his studies of theology. Matter of fact, he thought he was going to fail. So he went before Our Lady and he asked her to please help him in his studies. And Our Lady, her statue came to life, and she said to him, "My son, I will bless you greatly, and you will do me great honors." And after that, he was given such a keen intellect, such a great mind, that he astounded his professors by how immediately he had such a great improvement in his ability. And as I said, he was a professor at the University of Paris. He's the one where he made his defense of the Immaculate Conception there. And as I said, he went and he passed away at the age of 42. So he didn't have much of a long life, but he really affected and made a profound influence on theology. We had a professor who said there's not been a decent theologian since 1308. So he was really a profound and scholastic theologian, and we hope someday he'll be canonized. Just think, he died in 1308 and he has not yet been canonized. And I think it's because the devil hates him so much because he defined the Immaculate Conception. And we pray that he'll someday become saint and a doctor of the church and the Marian doctor that he really was. But Blessed John Duns Scotus said that, we're going to start with the Immaculate Conception. Even though it's not the first of the dogmas defined by the church, it is the first grace that Our Lady received, because it is the grace that Our Lady was most profoundly grateful for. As you know, when Our Lady appeared to Saint Bernadette, in Lourdes, France, in 1858, St. Bernadette's pastor did not believe that she was receiving messages from the Blessed Virgin Mary. He thought she was being deceived by some evil spirit. So he said to her, "Bernadette, I want you to ask the beautiful lady, what is your name?" And so Bernadette, when Our Lady appeared to her, said, "Beautiful lady, my pastor has asked me to ask you, what is your name?" And Our Lady looked up to heaven, and then she looked down at the ground and humility in her hands, dropped down at her side as if weighted down, St. Bernadette says, as if her hands were so heavy that they just fell at her side. And she said, in very humble way, "I am the Immaculate Conception." Now, the Immaculate Conception, as you know, was defined on December 8th, 1854, by Blessed Pius IX. So it's only been 4 years since it was proclaimed as a dogma of the Church. So St. Catherine, or St. Bernadette, didn't want to forget, and she always said she kind of had a bad memory. So all the way back to her pastor, she kept repeating to herself, "I am the Immaculate Conception, I am the Immaculate Conception, I am the Immaculate Conception." When she met the pastor, he said, "Well, Bernadette, did the beautiful lady tell you her name?" And she said, "Yes, Father." She said, "I am the Immaculate Conception." And he said, "Bernadette, do you know what the Immaculate Conception is, or who the Immaculate Conception is?" She says, "No, Father, I've never heard that word before, or that term." Because she wasn't lying, she was so sickly because of her asthma that she missed a lot of the catechism classes, and so she never heard that before. And when she said, "I am the Immaculate Conception," it convinced the priest that she was seeing Our Lady. And St. Maximian Kolbe, later on, when reflecting on this message of Our Lady and her words to Bernadette, said, "I am the Immaculate Conception." He said, "What is a conception? A conception is the fruit of love between two persons." And he said, "Could we not say that within the Trinity that the love for the Father and the love for the Son is a conception, that the fruit of their love is the third person of the Holy Trinity, the eternal person, the eternal conception, you might say, of the Holy Spirit?" So he said, "Could we not call the Holy Spirit the uncreated Immaculate Conception, because there's no sin in the Trinity?" And so he said, "That seems like a logical conclusion that we can draw." He said, "Outside of the Trinity, can we say that the fruit of the love for the Father and the fruit of the Son's love for the Father has some terminus, some point in creation where they meet?" And he said, "Yes, in the created Immaculate Conception." And so he said, "We could really say that Our Lady is pretty much kind of like, since the spouse of the Holy Spirit, she is Mrs. Immaculate Conception. Our Lady is so united in that union that she has with the Holy Spirit that she is truly His spouse." That, you know who used that phrase or referred to Our Lady in the history of the Church, who used that term first before anyone else, referring to Our Lady as the spouse of the Holy Spirit? What great theologian referred to Our Lady as spouse of the Holy Spirit? It was our Holy Father, St. Francis. St. Francis, in a prayer that he had composed, in which he refers to Our Lady's relationship to each of the three persons of the Blessed Trinity, he says that she is the firstborn daughter of the Eternal Father. That sounds very much like Blessed John Duns Scotus. Our Lord is the firstborn of creation of all men. Our Lady is the firstborn daughter. And already he might say, because God already had in mind the woman who would be the mother of His Son. So she's the firstborn daughter of the Father. She is the mother of the Eternal Son, and she is the spouse of the Holy Spirit. So St. Maximian Kolbe said this spousal union that Our Lady has is so unique. He said even to say that it's a spousal union doesn't really do its justice, how much united that the Holy Spirit and Our Lady are united in this bond of love. Although they are two different persons, one's an infinite divine person, the Holy Spirit, and the other is a created person, person, Our Lady, the Immaculate Conception, for all purposes, because of this grace of the Immaculate Conception, Our Lady only wills what God wants. She has no other will than what God wants. And so their wills are so perfectly united that they act as one. And he said, this is the way you can look at it, that Our Lady's will and God's will are like two rivers. You have this little river flowing into the bigger one, like the Ohio River or the Missouri River flowing into the Mississippi. And he says, can you find where when those two waters come together, can you differentiate them? No, for all purposes, they become one. You don't see water from the Missouri and water from the Ohio in the Mississippi. It all becomes one at a certain point. And he said, this is the way Our Lady and the Holy Spirit are so united. He says, to do Our Lady's will is to do the will of the Holy Spirit, because she has no other will than the Holy Spirit. And that's why God chose her to be his mother, because her will was so united to God's will. And that's the only one who could be truly worthy to be his mother, is that person who, as we heard in Genesis 3:15, there's enmity between her and the devil. Because her will is never going to be under the dominion of Satan. Her will is only and always will be forever with God and only for God. Blessed John Duns Scotus, getting back to him now, he said, well, how do we explain the Immaculate Conception? Blessed John Duns Scotus, in a logical thinking, said this: God is perfect, right? Jesus is God, right? And so therefore he's perfect, and everything he does is perfect. So when he did the redemption, he's a perfect redeemer, right? Yes. So that means if he's a perfect redeemer, that means there has to be at least one member of the human race who was perfectly redeemed, or he's not a perfect redeemer. That's true. So he said, what is more perfect? Is it more perfect to get sick and be given the cure, or to be given, you might say, an inoculation so you never get sick to begin with? He said the first type is called liberative redemption. The second, the more perfect, is called preservative redemption. And he said that Our Lady, because she was to be from all eternity the mother of the Son of God, God preserved his mother by the foreseen merits of Jesus Christ, that she would not suffer the effects of original sin or the stain of original sin, and never ever have any sin on her soul. So that's how he reasoned into the Immaculate Conception, that our Lord is the perfect redeemer, and there has to be at least one member of the human race who is perfectly redeemed, and it is his mother. Another saint one time said, well, being that a king can, because he has the power over his kingdom, he can put everybody in his kingdom under interdict. It means he can put them all under a certain penalty. But he can, because he's king, he can choose whoever he wants to dispense, or he can not permit that in that person's particular. He can have friends. He says, well, I won't let that person fall under that punishment because they're my friend. He says the same goes with God. All of us fall under this pain of original sin, but God of his own will make exceptions to that rule, and he made that exception for his mother, and he would have every right to, and it would be proper for the son, and that God would do that for his own mother. So that's why Our Lady is immaculately conceived, is because, as St. Maximin Kolbe said, Our Lady is immaculate because she's the mother of God, and she's the mother of God because she's immaculate. Now, Immaculate Conception, the proof, one of the proof texts, as I told you, is Genesis 3:15 about this enmity. There's never going to be any time when she's under the dominion of the devil. But there's another way of looking at her being the Immaculate Conception, and it's revealed when the angel Gabriel came to her and he said, Hail! What did he say? Did he say, Rejoice, O highly favored daughter? Or did he say, Hail Mary? What did he say? He said, Ave gratia plena, Hail, full of grace. Now, full of grace, if you're full of grace, that means there's no room for what? Sin. So another, you might say, proof of Our Lady's Immaculate Conception is in the words of the angel Gabriel to her. Now the Polish, when they say the Hail Mary, They have a little nuance when they say it that is not so obvious maybe in our English. Waskipelna. Waskipelna in Polish means you're so full, you're full to the rim, to the brim, you can't stick any more in them. And that's what Our Lady is, so full of grace, you can't, there's no more room to put any more in her. That means there's no room to put any sin in her either. So the Immaculate Conception was defined. And this is, as we read this the other day, from Blessed Pius IX, when he proclaimed Our Lady's Immaculate Conception, he said this, from his encyclical, Ineffabilis Deus. And now this was December 8th, 1854. From the very beginning and before time began, the Eternal Father chose and prepared for his only begotten Son a mother in whom the Son of God would become incarnate and from whom, in the blessed fullness of time, he would be born into this world. Above all creatures did God so loved her that truly in her was the Father well pleased with singular delight. Therefore, far above all the angels and all the saints, so wondrously did God endow her with the abundance of all heavenly gifts poured from the treasury of his divinity, that this mother, ever absolutely free of all stain of sin, all fair and perfect, would possess that fullness of holy innocence and sanctity than which, under God, one cannot even imagine anything greater, and which outside of God, no man can succeed in comprehending fully. Now the fullness of grace of Our Lady, that means if you and I have received any grace, she received it in its fullness. And we've only have a share in that fullness of grace that Our Lady has. If we have honesty, if we have, you know, purity, Our Lady has it to the full. She has it to the max. She is, that's why she didn't say, I am the one immaculately conceived. She says, I am the Immaculate Conception. She identifies herself with that grace. Lest as if, you know, when Moses asked God from the burning bush, who are you? He said, I am who am. So this is like a defining statement of who Our Lady is. She is the Immaculate Conception. And so she is, when sometimes you hear people say, well, Our Lady was just a typical young lady of the first century, you know, and that it was nothing particularly different about her. Well, she may have been very much hidden and humble, but there was no woman like Our Lady in the Immaculate Conception and whose holiness, no, all the saints and all the angels put together will not equal the holiness of Our Lady. After God, the holiness of Our Lady. Just as God is so above Our Lady in holiness, so Our Lady by her Immaculate Conception is so far above us that she is in a particular order all by herself. She is in the, as our professor said, she is in the order of the hypostatic union because she is to be the mother of the Son of God. She's not God, but she is the mother of God. And St. Maximian Kolbe says, for you to understand the Immaculate Conception and what it means to be the mother of God, you have to be God, because it is so, it's such a exalted grace that God gave to her. To be the mother of God is profound. And hence, the very words with which sacred scriptures speak of uncreated wisdom and set forth his eternal origin, the church, both in its ecclesiastical offices and in its liturgy, has been wont to apply likewise to the origin of the Blessed Virgin, inasmuch as God, by one and the same decree, had established the origin of Mary and the incarnation of divine wisdom, so that she is immaculate from the first moment of her existence, from her conception, and she is therefore full of every grace, and never ever was she under sin's dominion. So that this is why St. Maximian Kolbe said, I must consecrate myself to her, because her will and God's will. Sometimes people would say to St. Maximian Kolbe, well, why do you say, you know, he says, I don't have to say I'm doing God's will and Our Lady's will. He said, that's being redundant. He said, Our Lady's will is God's will because of the Immaculate Conception. He said, I don't have to keep saying, he said, we have a printing press here which we use to print all the publications and the books that we sell or that we hand out. And the factory that made this beautiful printing press, this high state-of-the-art printing press, he said, I don't have to keep saying, and it's thanks to that printing press and to that factory that made it that we're able to do this. He said, it's enough that I praise their product that I am also praising the one who made it. So he said, I don't have to be so redundant. I say I'm doing Our Lady's will. Thanks be to Our Lady for helping us. I'm also thanking God who created her to be that instrument of His grace for us. So our Lord is not offended if you praise His mother. He is very happy that you praise Him because that is His greatest work. And just like any artist would not be offended if you praised Him for His greatest work, you know, if you went to Michelangelo and said, well, Michelangelo, that was a wonderful thing you did in the Sistine Chapel, and he would say, well, no, don't talk about me, don't talk about my work. No, he'd be very happy and flattered that you talked about His great work. And so our Lord is greatly flattered and greatly pleased when we praise Him for His mother. And of course, as you know, St. Louis de Montfort says, every time you say Hail Mary, she says, blessed be God. So Our Lady always redounds the glory given to her. She passes it to her son. But you know, Pope John Paul II said one time, he said, you know, in one of his books, I think it was one of the books he wrote about his priesthood, he said, I always understood that Our Lady leads us to Jesus. He said, but I came to understand later on in life that Jesus leads us to His mother. And it's very clear from the foot of the cross. He says, looks down, and says, woman, behold your son. Son, behold your mother. So Pope John Paul II verifies that it's very important that Our Lady is in our life. And because of the absolute primacy of Christ, the incarnation was always intended, and all the grace is the grace of Christ. That means that Our Lady's role in the work of salvation is essential and necessary. It's not something, she's not an accessory that you can take her or leave her. She's part of the standard way in which God has distributed grace. And Blessed Columba Marmion says this, and I think it sums it up perfectly. Blessed Columba Marmion, in his book, Christ, the Life of the Soul, says this, no piety would be truly Christian if it did not include in its object the mother of the Word incarnate. Devotion towards the Virgin Mary is not only important, but necessary. If we wish to draw abundantly at the source of life, to separate Christ from His mother in our piety is to divide Christ. To separate Christ from His mother in our piety is to divide Christ. It is to lose sight of the essential mission of His sacred humanity in the distribution of grace. Where the mother is left out, the son is no longer understood. Where the mother is left out, the son is no longer understood. That's how important Our Lady is to understanding who Jesus is. And in this little book here, Mary's Mission, Apostolic Mission and Ours, it's one of our books that we publish, Father Emil Noubert, who is the author, he's also the author of this book, Mary and the Priestly Ministry. We have other books of his that we offer on our website. He was St. Maximian Kolbe's favorite Mariologist. He was a contemporary of St. Maximian Kolbe, and he was a Marist father, and he wrote many books. And in this book, he writes something that it very much proves the point of what Blessed Columba Marmion says here. He writes this on page 31. He says, this is the same principle we find implied in the attitude of certain modern heretics. Around the middle of the 19th century, Dr. Pusey, a progressive Anglican theologian, had mentioned in a book entitled Peaceful, the conditions under which the Anglican Church might unite with the Catholic Church. He had particularly stated the abandonment of the Catholic Church's idolatrous cult of Mary. Cardinal Newman, his former friend, answered him in a letter, a veritable treatise, which perhaps constitutes the most beautiful writing of the 19th century on devotion to Mary. Pusey had claimed that the cult we render to Mary must necessarily relegate her divine son into the shadows. Newman first asks that the statement be proven. Then he adds, there is another fact, one that speaks very loudly, it seems to me. If we cast a glance over Europe, what do we see? In fact, the countries and the peoples who have lost faith in the divinity of Christ are precisely those who have abandoned devotion toward his mother. Those, on the contrary, who have more especially honored her, have preserved their orthodoxy. Compare, for example, the Greeks from the Calvinists, France with northern Germany, or the Catholics with the Protestants in Ireland. It is still a fact that the countries and the peoples who have lost their faith in the divinity of Christ are also those who have rejected the virginity of Mary. And so, Blessed John Henry Cardinal Newman points out that Our Lady really is the key to orthodoxy. That's one of her oldest titles, the key or the surety of orthodoxy. If you remain true devotion to Our Lady, you will always remain faithful to Christ. And she's not an obstacle to Christ. She is the means by which we arrive at him most surely. And so the Immaculate Conception, that first grace that she received, is her most beautiful grace that she's most happy. That's how she referred to herself. I am the Immaculate Conception. That's why St. Maximine Kolbe referred to her as the Immaculata. He would always call her the Immaculata in Latin, meaning the Immaculate One. And that's why we call ourselves the Franciscans of the Immaculate, because we just translated it into Immaculate instead of Immaculata. And so everybody says, oh, are you immaculate? That's an adjective. What else is there behind that? No, it's just immaculate. So that's why we say of the Immaculate, because we're her property and her possession. So it's the genitive of that. We're her possession. We belong to her. So it's interesting that St. Maximine Kolbe uses this analogy of the will of Our Lady and the will of God so united as being a river, because we have a perfect example of it in our country. You know what the name of the Mississippi River was before it was called the Mississippi? You know what the Spanish missionaries called the Mississippi River? They called it the Immaculate Conception. And so I like that name. I think we should contact President Trump and say, let's change the name back. You know, everybody wants to get back to their native origins. So let's get back to what it was really called before we were a country. Let's go back to the Immaculate Conception. I think that's a better name for that river. Maybe it wouldn't flood all the time if we would call it by that name. Anyway, so that's the Immaculate Conception. And so it's really, there's so much more. We're going to talk about it a little more as we go on, but I'm going to move on now to the two doctrines that are probably more not as well understood. And the first one, of course, is Our Lady is the Theotokos, the Mother of God, and her perpetual virginity, which we spoke about just briefly yesterday. Because, of course, the first of the dogmas defined by Our Lady was that she was the Mother of God. And that was in 431 AD when the Bishop of Constantinople, the Patriarch of Constantinople, Nestorius, was teaching heresy. He would not refer to Our Lady as Theotokos. He called her the Theodokos, which was a little nuance, a little change. She wasn't God-bearer, but somehow it had a different meaning than Theotokos. Or he called her Christotokos, the Mother of Christ, but he would never refer to her as the Mother of God, because he believed that Christ was two persons, that he was a human person and he was a divine person, and that this divine person was using this human person kind of like as a demigod. And so he didn't believe that Our Lady was not the mother of God, but just of this Christ, separated him out. You know, he's just the mother of this human part. And so the people of his diocese turned him in. They said, our bishop is a heretic pope. We need to have you come down here and resolve this. Is Our Lady Theotokos or not? So he called for the council of Ephesus, and Nestorius refused to come to the council and defend his heresy. And he had such a good relationship with the emperor of the east that he protected him so they couldn't force him to come to the council. But as we know, at the Council of Ephesus, the fathers and doctors of the church and the council fathers finally settled a question, and it had to do with nature and person. They wanted to make sure we understood what nature and person means. Nature answers the question, what? Person answers the question, who? So when we say, what is Jesus? We're talking about his nature. He is true God and true man. But who is Jesus? Who is the subject of action? Who is the person performing the actions? He is God. And so they said, Jesus is one person with two natures. He has a human nature and a divine nature, but he is a divine person. That human nature is subsumed, is somehow attached to that divine person, and it's not, they don't become mixed together like a smoothie. They remain distinct, but yet our Lord's human nature has a human soul, he has a human intellect, he has a human will, but as a person, he's only a divine person. And they said that Our Lady didn't give birth to a nature, she gives birth to a person. And even though she had nothing to do with his divine nature, she is truly his mother. She gave birth to the person who is the second person of the Blessed Trinity. And you know, we can take this same analogy and we can say, what if you were to go into any hospital, any maternity ward, and you go in and you visit a mother who's got her little baby there in her arms, and you said, ma'am, is that your baby? And she says, yes, it is. And you say, oh, no, it's not. You're just the mother of that body, but you didn't have anything to do with the creation of his soul. That was made by God, so therefore you're just the mother of that baby's body. She would slap you. Because even though she didn't have anything to do with the creation of that immortal soul, she is truly the mother of that baby. And Our Lady is truly the mother of Jesus, the Son of God, because he chose to be her mother. She gave all of her nature, and only she gave of her human substance to Jesus. And from that, he took upon himself a human nature and joined it to his divine person. And so she truly is the mother of God. And so that's why the church has invoked ever since then, and we might say that's where the second part of the Hail Mary got its start, you might say, is at the Council of Ephesus, invoking Our Lady as the Mother of God. It became dogmatically defined and enshrined that we refer to Our Lady as the Mother of God, for she truly is his mother, and he treats her as his mother. You know, the saints and doctors say that when you ask something from Jesus, even the Saint Anthony or Saint Francis, if they ask something from Jesus, he treats it as a request from one of his nice, loyal, loving sons and daughters. But when Our Lady asks something from Jesus, he treats it as a command. And he truly honors his mother and treats her as such and obeys her. Nowhere do we see that our Lord disobeyed his mother ever in sacred scripture. Even when he talked to her rather strangely at the wedding feast of Cana, woman, what to me to thee? We talked about that yesterday, how he was giving us a clue to who this woman is. And even when he was lost from her, you know, he wasn't lost, but Mary and Joseph lost Jesus, and they went searching for him for 3 days. He said, why did you go looking for me? Did you know no, I'd be about my father's business or in my father's house? And she said, she pondered that in her heart. Didn't know what he meant by that. But he wasn't being disobedient to her. He allowed her and Joseph to wander off and lose track of him. But he was preparing his mother. And we're going to talk about that a little later, the significance of why he was lost for 3 days and what he was teaching his mother and what she learned about this in pondering it in her heart. So the divine maternity, she truly is his mother. And he treats her as his mother. And she has that certain authority as his mother, that our Lord cannot deny her anything that she asks of him. And of course, she will never ask him anything that is contrary to his will. That's how united, as Pope John Paul II talks about the two hearts of Jesus and Mary, those two hearts, do not act as, for all purposes, they act as one. Just as she's so united in that spousal union to the Holy Spirit, so united is she to Christ in her heart that she only wants and loves what Christ wants. So that was defined in 431 AD at the Council of Ephesus, that Our Lady is the Theotokos, the God-bearer, the Mother of God. And the people were greatly rejoiced over that. They had a big celebration in Ephesus when they announced that she was the Theotokos, because they knew that she was. Nestorius, sad to say, he never, ever renounced his heresy, and he died a horrible death. Never accepted the council's teaching. And the perpetual virginity of Our Lady, I want to share something with you because it's so important. As you know, we talked yesterday briefly about the perpetual virginity, that the Church defines Our Lady's perpetual virginity. The first time it was defined under anathema was around 549 AD by at the Council of Chalcedon, in which they said that she was a perpetual virgin. And the Church has defined it subsequently that she was a virgin before the birth of Christ, she was a virgin during the birth of Christ, and she was a virgin after the birth of Christ. In the passage from St. Luke's Gospel, there's a key already in what the angel says to Our Lady that indicates that there's something unique about this conception that will be unlike any other conception before this time. And this little insight was pointed out by a very fine Jesuit scripture scholar, Father, I think he was from Trinidad, Father Bona, I can't remember his name right at the top of my head, but he is the one that pointed this out. In the passage of the Annunciation, there's a phrase that appears, and I'm going to share that with you. Beginning with verse 30, and the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for thou hast found grace with God. Behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb, and shalt bring forth a son, and thou shalt call him his name Jesus." Conceive in your womb. St. Luke uses this expression twice. It only appears twice in all of the Bible, and St. Luke uses it in his gospel. Only he uses it. And St. Luke was a doctor. In other expressions in the Old Testament, in the Bible, when a woman is with child, say, "Receive in your womb," or "the woman is with child," but they never said, "Conceive in your womb." And I shared this with a friend of mine who's a neonatologist for over 50 years. I said, "Doctor, the angel Gabriel said to Our Lady that she will conceive in her womb." He said, "Well, that's not right. That's incorrect. That's not true. That's not how biology works." He said, "Conception doesn't take place in the womb. Conception takes place in the fallopian tube. And then the child goes to the womb, to the uterus, and there he attaches himself to her womb. But conception does not take place in the womb. It takes place in the fallopian tube." I said, "But doctor, sacred scripture is infallible. It's without error." He's trying to tell us that there's something different about this conception. There's no need for the conception for it to take place in the fallopian tube because there's no one contributing anything from outside of Our Lady for this human nature of our Lord except Our Lady. So the conception takes place within a closed womb. And the angel said that twice. He says again, or not the angel, but St. Luke writes again in verse 2, or chapter 2, verse 20, I believe it is, and when 8 days were fulfilled for his circumcision, his name was called Jesus, the name given him by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. So that this conception was unlike any other conception because it took place in that closed womb. And the angel indicates that by his expression to her, "You will conceive in your womb." So the Holy Spirit does know biology. So the angel is saying this conception is unlike any other. So how are we to know that the birth is therefore has to also be miraculous to show that the conception was miraculous? And that's why the fathers and doctors, I said yesterday, said that when our Lord was born, He passed through his mother's womb like light passing through a shadow. Through a window. It did not disturb her closed womb. Our Lady was physically intact, a virgin when our Lord was born. And during the process of birth, he passed through her womb like light through a window. One minute he was in her womb, the next minute he was in her arms. There was no afterbirth. There was none of the other things that you would find in regular childbirth, because Our Lady didn't have a typical childbirth. And I hate all these movies of our Lord showing his mother giving birth, wailing and having labor pains, because Our Lady did not have labor pains. Because she was not, first of all, labor pains were for those who were under the stain of original sin. So therefore, she was not under the stain of original sin, so she had no need to have, she wasn't punished with labor pains. And second of all, the birth of our son was so miraculous that he passed through her womb without disturbing or causing her any pain. For her, her birth of her son was pure joy. Now, she did have labor pains later on, but it wasn't giving birth to the head of the church in Christ. Her labor pains was given to her at the foot of the cross when she gave birth to the rest of her children. And those labor pains would have killed any mother if it wasn't for the fact of their Immaculate Conception, because they were the most profound pain that any woman underwent at the foot of the cross. And here we can take as a quote from the fathers and doctors regarding Our Lady's perpetual virginity. This is what some of the fathers have to say. This is what Pope John Paul II has to say. Mary was therefore a virgin before the birth of Jesus, and she remained a virgin in giving birth and after the birth. This is the truth presented by the New Testament text, and which was expressed both by the Fifth Ecumenical Council at Constantinople in 533, which speaks of Mary as ever virgin, and also by the Lateran Council in 649, which teaches that the Mother of God, Mary, conceived her son through the power of the Holy Spirit without human intervention, and in giving birth to him, her virginity remained incorrupted, and even after the birth, her virginity remained intact. He said that on January 28, 1987. And then we have this from St. Ambrose. According to the condition of the body, Jesus was in the womb. He nursed at his mother's breast. He lay in the manger. But superior to that condition, the Virgin conceived and the Virgin bore, so that you might believe that he was God, who restored nature, though he was a man, who in accord with nature was born of a human being. Though coming in the form of man, yet not in everything is he subject to the laws of man's nature. For while his being born of a woman tells of human nature, virginity becoming capable of childbirth betokens something above man. Of him, then, his mother's burden was light, the birth immaculate, the delivery without pain, the nativity without defilement, neither beginning from wanton desire nor brought to pass with sorrow. For as she who by her guilt engrafted death into our nature was condemned to bring forth in trouble, it was meet that she who brought life into the world should accomplish her delivery with joy. St. Gregory of Nyssa wrote that in 388 AD. And that she gave birth, according to the prophet Isaiah, before she was in travail. So that means she didn't have any labor. She gave birth before she was in travail. She never had any travail, because her child was born miraculously, like light passing through a window. And as I told you, the fathers and doctors saw this connection between our Lord's miraculous birth, issuing forth from the virginal womb, to be also significant as the fact that he issued forth from that closed tomb at the end of his, and when he was in the tomb, he issued forth without disturbing that closed tomb. You know, he didn't roll back the stone. He passed through it like light passing through a window, just as he would appear in the upper room to his apostles. He appeared and the door was shut. Our Lord didn't say, "Let me in." He just, voila, here I am. He passed through the closed door. Our Lord did that, and the closed womb and the closed tomb are the signs of his divinity. So the perpetual virginity is that great sign. How do we know that Jesus is greater than Muhammad? How do we know that Jesus is greater than Buddha or any other religious figure? Because his mother is the perpetual virgin. No one else can claim that as their credentials. This is God because his mother is the perpetual virgin. It is unlike anything. No man can do that. And as I told you, St. Bonaventure said, only God could be born from a virgin while remaining a virgin, and only a virgin is worthy to be the mother of God. That's the beauty of that mystery of her perpetual virginity, and that's why that is entailed in the creed. Every time we say the Nicene Creed, or when we say the Apostles' Creed, we say born of the Virgin Mary. That means ever Virgin Mary. And we know that she was a virgin after the birth of Christ and until the day our Lord died, because our Lord gave her into the care of John. And of course, if Our Lady had any other surviving children, it would have been proper for our Lord to give her to one of his siblings, and he had no siblings. He only had cousins. And that's what it means. The brothers of our Lord were his cousins. You know, we say, this is my kinfolk. Well, they didn't have a word for kinfolk in Hebrew. They said, this is their brothers and sisters are outside. That means his relatives. But none of them were his brothers and sisters of Our Lady. Our Lady had only one. As the fathers and doctors said, Jesus is only begotten from his Father in his divine nature. God in his divine nature only has one Son. And he's only begotten in his human nature from Our Lady. Our Lady has only one child. And to be the firstborn does not imply secondborn. For there is a tombstone that says in the ancient Egypt that this woman died in giving birth to her firstborn son. Well, she didn't have any more after that because she was dead. But yet she had a firstborn son. Firstborn does not imply that there's a secondborn. Firstborn means as a special title, that you are the first. And even it says that Michal, the wife of David, who mocked him because he danced before the Ark of the Covenant, God struck her with barrenness, said she bore no children until her death. Does that mean she had children after her death? No. So until doesn't imply anything after that. It means to that point. So Our Lady was a virgin always, ever virgin. And that's the great, so that was defined under anathema by the church. So that is, we have the Immaculate Conception, we have the Divine Maternity, we have the Perpetual Virginity. The last of the defined dogmas, of course, is the Assumption of the Blessed Virgin Mary, body and soul, into heaven by Pius XII on November 1st, All Saints' Day in 1950. And, of course, that dogma was proclaimed that said that, if we'll find it here, this is from, I believe, the encyclical Munificentissimus Deus. This is what he said, Pius XII. Hence, the revered Mother of God from all eternity, joined in a hidden way with Jesus Christ, in one and the same decree of predestination, here we see that joint predestination, and he repeats all of her defined dogmas, immaculate in her conception, a most perfect virgin in her divine motherhood, the noble associate of the divine Redeemer who has won a complete triumph over sin and its consequences, finally obtained as the supreme culmination of her privileges that she should be preserved free from the corruption of the tomb, and that like her own son, having overcome death, she might be taken up body and soul into the glory of heaven, where as queen she sits in splendor at the right hand of her son, the immortal king of the ages. So it means that the completion of her earthly life, Our Lady was assumed body and soul into heaven. And why? Well, Pius XII goes on to say, well, she was assumed because She was immaculate, and she shouldn't be tainted by the grave because she was without sin. She was the mother of God, and such a worthy vessel to bear God should not suffer the effects of the grave. She was the perpetual virgin. That means she was undefiled, so therefore she shouldn't be in the grave. And he gives another one. He says, because she also participated in a unique way in the redemption of mankind. She participated in a unique way in the acquisition of the graces of redemption, and therefore she has to be in heaven where she can distribute those graces. So actually, he already is implying that there's a fifth dogma that should be proclaimed if we want to get everything right, because he talks about her unique participation in the work of redemption. And so it leads us right into why there should be five dogmas and not four. That Our Lady has a unique role to play in redemption. It's called the co-redemptrix. Now, people, can they hear that, they go, oh, what does that mean? Co-redemptrix. Does that mean co-equal? No. It means co from the Latin, meaning cum, with. Redemptrix, meaning the feminine counterpart of the Redeemer. She who was with the Redeemer. She who is subordinate to the Redeemer, but had a unique role and an important role to play in the work of redemption. How do we know that it's an important role? Because where did he take his human nature from that he offered for us on the cross? Where was our Lord ordained a priest? Where did he receive his priesthood? In the womb of Our Lady. Because the day he received his human nature was the day he could offer it in sacrifice. So his ordination took place in the womb of Our Lady. That's why she's the mother of all priests, because she's the mother of the high priest. And so she has a unique role to play in the sacrifice. It says in wisdom that wisdom has mixed its drinks and has prepared a sacrifice. Well, truly Our Lady, by her saying yes to being the mother of God, has prepared a sacrifice. She knew that when she said yes to the angel Gabriel, that she was saying yes to being also the co-redemptrix. Why? Because Our Lady knew very well that redemption is only done, atonement is only done by the shedding of blood. She knew sacred scripture very well. There's no atoning for sin without the shedding of blood. And she also knew that that name implied sacrifice, because what did he tell? The angel said, you're going to name him what? Jesus, which means God saves. Well, how's he going to save someone who's in sin? By the shedding of his blood. So Our Lady probably thought that when our Lord was taken to the temple on the eighth day and he was going to be circumcised, maybe she thought that was going to be the blood that God would require. It's just that blood shed by his circumcision. But what did the prophet Simeon say to her? He said, this son shall be a sign of contradiction, and a sword of sorrow shall pierce your own heart, your own soul too. He was prophesying that these two hearts, these two persons have a unique bond together. They are both part of the sacrifice that God is going to require. You know, we know that in the Old Testament, they had the Old Testament sacrifice of the Paschal Lamb, which represents Christ. You know, when John the Baptist saw Jesus, he said, behold, the Lamb of God. Every good Jew knew that that was a messianic term. So in the temple, they had the sacrifice of the Lamb, the Paschal Lamb, to remind us of the sacrifice of Christ. But you know, they also had a sacrifice that represented Our Lady. For purification rites in the Old Testament, they sacrificed a three-year-old heifer. What's a heifer? It's a virgin cow. And so we see in that a type of Our Lady, that for purification, they had to sacrifice a virgin, a heifer cow. Had to be 3 years old. And so we see even in the temple sacrifices that Our Lady's sacrifice is not separate or somehow in competition to Christ's sacrifice. It's the same sacrifice. Because our Lord asked his mother, by her saying yes to being his mother, saying yes to being the co-redemptrix. She who would participate with the Redeemer in the work of redemption. And not only did he want her to provide the substance for the sacrifice by helping him to give a body to him, but he also asked for her consent. God required her to say yes She had to give her consent. Not only did Jesus go to the cross doing the will of his heavenly Father, he went to the cross doing the will of his mother. How do we know that? Because at the wedding feast of Cana, Our Lady says, "Son, they have no wine." And he says to her, very stark, "Woman, what to me to thee? My hour has not yet come." Whenever our Lord referred to hour, he meant his passion. And so he's saying to him, in one sense, he's saying to him, his mother Mary, "Remember what to me to thee, woman, my hour has not yet come. My passion hasn't yet arrived. But what to me, to thee." And did Our Lady say, "Oh, well, let's think about this for a minute." She just, without even hesitating, she turned to the servant and said, "Do whatever he tells you." In other words, she's saying, "Yes, son, your hour has come. We're getting ready to go to Calvary." Why? Because he works his first public miracle at Cana, and the cat will be out of the bag. Everybody's going to know that he's not just this nice guy, but he can do some really amazing things. He can change water into wine. And it says that at the wedding feast of Cana, his disciples began to believe in him. They already got the first, might say, seed of faith planted in their hearts and souls through the mediation of the Blessed Virgin Mary. This is the other part. She's already a mediatrix. She's mediating between the graces that God wants to give. Where's the other place she mediates? When he was only a baby, not even a few days in her womb. She takes Jesus to her cousin Elizabeth, who represents Elizabeth. Elzabeth means house of God, means she's a type of the church. And in Elizabeth, she's got little John the Baptist in her womb, 6 months old. And Elizabeth says, the moment your greeting sounded in my ears, the babe leapt for joy. God waited for Our Lady to use her voice before he conveyed the grace of sanctification to John the Baptist and filled Elizabeth with the Holy Spirit. But it was at Our Lady's word. God used her as his mediatrix. You know, she just didn't come into the door and all of a sudden grace was given. He waited for her to say shalom, peace. And truly peace was given, the peace of God. The peace that only can come from being sanctified. Like St. John the Baptist was sanctified and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. So Our Lady is a mediatrix. She's a mediatrix first and foremost because she's a mother. All mothers, as we said yesterday, are mediatrixes. You stand between you and your children. You're between the father and the rest of the family. You mediate life. You're a mediatrix. Our Lady is a mediatrix of the life that God has given to us. He is the head of the church. We are the members. And the Father said she is the neck of the church that connects the head with the members. You can't live without your neck. There's a lot of people out there trying to separate us from our heads, from our necks. That's very diabolical. So, and there's a proverb in Polish that says that the father is the head of the family and the mother is the neck, and wherever the neck turns, the head follows. Well, that's pretty much the way the relationship is with Jesus and his mother. He obeys his mother. Wherever the neck turns, he says, "Okay, Mom, what do you want me to do for you?" He didn't say to her, "Well, my hour's not yet come, don't bother me." She said, "Well, you're my son, you're going to do whatever I tell him. Go do whatever he says to do." And Jesus doesn't say, "Oh, Mom, why are you going to do that for?" He just obeys. He says, "Go and fill those stone water jars and come back, take them to the waiter." And so here is Our Lady acting as the mediatrix. And then we see that God puts her in that role because he says, before he passes and before he dies, he says, "Woman, behold your son. Son, behold your mother." And he took her into his home, into his own. And what does our Lord say after that? In the Latin, it's much more obvious what our Lord is saying. It doesn't say "it is finished." If you look in the Latin, it says, He says, consummatum est, it is consummated. What is consummated? That birth. Here's in the first of the rest of her children in John, the disciple whom Jesus loved, which represents all of us. That's why we know that we were all born at the foot of the cross as the rest of her children. That's the travail that Our Lady was in when she experienced great pain. So we're the children of her greatest pain. And so she loves us because we cost her dearly. It cost her her most beloved son. And so she treasures that which cost her so much, and she is treasures that, and she is wanting to save every child given to her. And so since she participated in a unique way in the acquisition of those graces by standing there at the foot of the cross, standing, not swooning, not falling over, because she was standing there as the valiant woman offering Jesus for our sins, and she was offered with him. There's one suffering that our Lord did not suffer at Calvary. Which one was that? When his heart was pierced, he was dead. But there's someone who experienced that suffering profoundly, and that was his mother. She experienced that sorrow and that suffering to the max. The fathers and doctors say that our Lord redeemed us by his passion. Our Lady redeemed us by her compassion, by suffering with Jesus. And if Jesus would have given her permission, she would have wanted to die on the cross with him, but our Lord would not give her that permission because she was to suffer and offer. And the greatest suffering that our Lord had was to see the suffering that he would inflict upon his mother because she would have to witness it. Our Lady was not like this at the foot of the cross. She took it all in because everything she wanted to take and offer for our salvation. So she laid her heart bare to everyone. If there, you know, what is Our Lady's sorrows? It's seven swords piercing that heart because it's the fullness of sorrows. Yet she had the fullness of joys. And so we get back to our Lord's lost for 3 days when he was 12 years old. And he said to her, woman, why did you go looking for me? Did you not know I'd be about my father's business? And it said that she pondered that in her heart. 21 years later, at the foot of the cross, she would lose her son for 3 days. But she would not go looking for him. She would not go and be in anguish, wondering what happened to him, because she knew that he would be about his father's business, in his father's house. So it's been the tradition of the church that Our Lady didn't go to the tomb looking for Jesus. She didn't go there because she knew he wouldn't be there. If our Lord told his apostles many times that he would suffer a terrible torture, die, and rise on the third day, and they said, what does he mean by resurrection from the dead? I'm sure our Lord instructed his mother many times when they were together for those 30 years that he was hidden in that hidden life. He instructed her about his work, and he told her about the resurrection that would take place. And though she didn't understand it maybe completely, finally at the foot of the cross, she understood very well that she was going to lose him for 3 days, and that the only one who believed in the resurrection on that between Good Friday and Easter Sunday was the Blessed Virgin Mary. That's why on every Saturday we honor Our Lady in a special way. Saturday is her day because it reminds us of that first Holy Saturday when the faith of the church was the faith of Mary. It's Mary's faith that was the faith of the church until Easter Sunday when our Lord appeared. She was not in that sense surprised because she knew that his words would be fulfilled. And so even Pope John Paul II talks about that when Our Lady, he says it's well worth to know that in tradition that the first person our Lord appeared to when he rose from the dead was his own mother. Because she had every rights, since she participated in such a unique way at the foot of the cross, she should be the first one to receive the news of the resurrection. Mary Magdalene was the rest of her children. The rest of us, poor sinners who were liberated, she was the first of the Marys the first of the rest of us to receive that news, but Our Lady is the one who received the news first of all. And that's why we sing at Easter time, Regina Caeli, Laetare, your son has risen as he truly said, rejoice and be glad, O Virgin Mary. So Our Lady is the co-redemptrix. This doctrine, this fifth one, is so important because it shows forth the universal co-redemption and mediation of all graces. If you received any grace, it's through the mediation of Our Lady. And no grace has come to us except through Our Lady. And St. Maximilian Kolbe writes this, and he says that her mediation began long before the cross. He says, from the moment in which that union took place, the incarnation in Mary's womb, the Holy Spirit gives no grace. The Father transmits to souls through the Son and Holy Spirit no supernatural life grace except through the mediatrix of all graces, the Immaculata, with her consent, with her collaboration. She receives all the treasures of grace as her property and distributes them to whom and in the measure that she wills. So that the Holy Spirit waits for Our Lady to say, give that one grace, give this one grace. Not because God has to, but because God is glorified in doing that. Our Lady participated in a unique way. That means we all must participate. Since Our Lady participated in a unique way at the foot of the cross in obtaining those graces, we have to participate in our redemption as well. St. Augustine said, God created us without our permission, but he will not redeem us without our cooperation. That's why it's so important that we're not just, oh, once saved, always saved. I just sit back and do nothing. No, we have to cooperate with God's grace. We have to respond and say yes. And if Our Lady's not co-redemptrix, then none of us can be co-redeemers with Christ. St. Paul says, I'm a co-redeemer with Christ. Well, if he can be a co-redeemer with Christ, then surely she who is his mother can be the co-redemptrix, who participated in a unique way, like no one else did, at the foot of the cross in our redemption. Why is it important that it be five dogmas and not four? Because I don't think we have given Our Lady her fullest and her, as I said, God wills the greatest glory. He wills the greatest glory for his mother. One of the last errors of our Protestant friends is that Christus solus heresy, that Christ alone. But Christ alone, when you say Christ alone, you mean Christ in his human nature. And he didn't get that human nature alone. God could have done it if he wanted to, but he didn't. He asked for the participation of a woman to give him that human nature. So Christ, and even Genesis 3:15, doesn't talk about just the seed. It says the woman and the seed, and that she will crush the head of Satan. We talked about Genesis 3:15 being repeated throughout the Old Testament. Different times we see this being played over and over again. When we go to the book of David and Goliath are having the great battle. David is a type of who? David is a type of who? Christ. Goliath is a type of who? The serpent, the devil. He and the Philistines are, you might say, the devil and his brood, warring against David and the chosen people of God. Where's Our Lady in the story of David and Goliath? What does David do? It says that David takes from the river how many stones? He takes five smooth stones. And he takes one of those smooth stones and he puts it in his sling and he goes and he swings it and it hits Goliath where? In the foot? In the chest? Hits him right between the eyes. Oh, she shall crush his head. So I think that in those five smooth, I see there's five dogmas of Our Lady, and until we have the five, we're not going to complete Our Lady's glory and give her all the grace and all that she needs in order to accomplish her task. That God is waiting for us, the church, to give her that glory. You know, the Pope has the power of the keys. He not only has the power to loosen or to bind, but he also has the power to loosen graces from heaven. And we need those graces loosened by proclaiming her as the co-redemptrix and mediatrix of all graces. Or we're not going to be able to finally get to that point where we can overcome the serpent and win the battle. Our Lady has to give all, God wants his mother to have all the glory that he wants for her and not just some. So I believe that it's key, and we're going to learn tomorrow when we talk about why Fatima, that I think that bears out very clearly in the message of Fatima as well, the importance of the fifth Marian dogma, that her universal co-redemption and mediation of all graces. So I would ask you to please pray that would become a reality, that we would proclaim Our Lady as a co-redemptrix and mediatrix and advocate. You know, people ask, you know, when Our Lady's Immaculate Conception, we know what that grace meant for her. But what is in it for me that Our Lady's immaculate? Well, she's immaculate because she's my co-redemptrix, she's my mediatrix, and she's my advocate. So it might say it also is a further completion of better understanding what does it mean that Our Lady is immaculately conceived. She has all these roles that she has to play in the mystical body of Christ. And as she is all those to us and even more. Let us pray that will become a reality, for I don't think that we will have the success in fighting the good fight until we do. For our Lord is waiting for us to give his mother that glory. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.